Hello everybody, my name is Rachel and welcome to another reading wrap-up. This is for the past 2 weeks because last weekend I didn't do a wrap-up, I did reviews instead. So let's get into it. The first thing I have to mention is that I did read Dangerous Visions. This is a science fiction anthology edited by Harlan Ellison. I did not enjoy this at all, and I have already put up an entire video talking about this anthology, what it is, the parts of it I really didn't like, and a couple of the stories that I did actually enjoy. But for the most part, this was quite a slog. I don't highly recommend reading it unless you're just really into science fiction history. After that, I read The Deep by John Crowley. This is a science fiction novel, a little unusual for Crowley. Most of his works are fantasy, I believe. And I believe this was his first ever published novel, and I think you can kind of see that, especially if you have read any of his later, more mature works. The style and the storytelling in this seems a little bit like a watered down, more tentative version of what he has actually become as a writer. I mainly thought this was all right. I struggled, I think, because the plot wasn't super interesting. It wasn't science fictional enough for me. It's really a science fiction world that resembles a medieval feudal fantasy world. This takes place on a world that's basically flat. I think it's like a flat disc on top of a gigantic pillar, which is suspended in the deep, which I think is just space. And this really does seem to be the actual structure of the physical world rather than something that the people believe. it seems to me like something that could be physically impossible in a science fictional world that's attempting realism in some way. There's actually no explanation for how this thing exists, which is one of my major frustrations. If you're going to introduce such a bizarre concept for a world and say that it's not fantasy, I want to know more about how that's possible. but basically, yeah, it's this feudal system, and most of the plot is about the fight for the throne. The current Black King is deposed by the Red Clan, and this emissary arrives. It is probably an android or a cyborg, and it probably arrives in a spaceship. And I'm saying it, even though in the story it's referred to as he, because it doesn't actually have any physical sexual characteristics. The book is in three parts, which kind of are the phases, the stages that this emissary goes through. When it arrives, it's called the Visitor and it can't remember its purpose. And then it becomes the Secretary and it kind of assists one of the factions. And then in the final part, it becomes the Recorder and remembers what its purpose is, which I think is still very fuzzy. Like, what was the point of all of this? You just have this alien observer arriving in the midst of a massive fight for a throne in a feudalistic society, and that's about it. Maybe I missed something, but frankly I was pretty bored by the end, so I didn't really care. The unusual thing about this book, though, is that I couldn't help but notice that there was something very similar in the type of story and in the characters, in the action, to like the historical plays by Shakespeare. In fact, I felt like this story would have been better if it were a play. The way that it's written, it's very distant feeling. You're not really inside of anybody's head. You don't really get to know anybody. The characters are not really people. They're more like archetypes and roles within the society. And I feel like if it were a play, it would just be open to more interpretation by the people actually performing the play, and you could really breathe more life and personality into the story. I just thought that was an unusual reaction. I don't think I've ever read a book before and thought, this shouldn't be a novel, it should be a play. Maybe I had plays on the brain or something, but yeah, The Deep, not my favorite thing by Crowley. Not a bad book, just I didn't feel like it was a particularly interesting or entertaining story by the end. Ms. Marvel, Volume 10, Time and Again. This is written by G. Willow Wilson, co-created with a bunch of other people. I don't actually remember who the primary artist was from this one. So Volume 10 of Ms. Marvel is the end of this run, as far as I can tell. Wilson has exited, the main artist has exited, and Saladin Ahmed and a new creative team are coming on for the next Ms. Marvel series. I've really enjoyed this series. I really liked this last volume. I thought for a while that when Wilson left, because I knew that was coming, I would probably stop reading at that point. I'm not super into the Marvel universe. But actually, as I was getting to the end of this volume, I found myself thinking, I will be really sad if I never come back to this character and never come back to her group of friends, because I think that the character of Ms. Marvel has been developed very well. There have been some really great story arcs in the series, and I love the supporting cast as well, and it's so diverse, you know? So yeah, I think I will continue reading at this point. I've asked my library if they will get the Magnificent Ms. Marvel series when it starts, so there is more of this character in my future. Then I listened to the audiobook of Circe by Madeline Miller. This is an insanely popular literary mythological fantasy novel. I'm not going to recap it. I think a lot of people already know about this one. So my main impressions. I thought that I didn't know that much about Circe as, let's say, a literary figure, a mythological figure, but actually, I guess I'd absorbed more from the collective consciousness than I new, because almost nothing in this book was surprising to me. I think the main problem I had is that it's not a retelling. It is really just the famous stories in which Circe appears, but from her perspective. It's very much about what it is to be Circe, what it is like to be a woman of this time period and this type of society, and what it's like to be a woman, a nymph, a witch, amongst the gods and the demigods and so on, and they're really, really unpleasant, actually. So, I think perhaps from a feminist perspective, this is kind of interesting, but frankly, I thought most of the actual book was pretty boring. Being inside of Circe's head was not a very interesting place, and I felt like her internal voice was very dull and monotonous, and she doesn't learn or change very fast, so the story spans like hundreds of years, and I'm like, you've been alive for 400 years and you're only just now figuring out maybe you shouldn't trust strange men when they set foot on your island, you know? But anyway, I don't think it's going to be my favorite thing from the fantasy category for the BookTube SFF Awards, but it wasn't bad either. Then I read Fruits Basket Another Volume 2 by Natsuki Takaya. Fruits Basket Another is a very short sequel series to Fruits Basket, which is Takaya's very famous best-selling manga series. And I am a huge fan of Fruits Basket, which is why I wanted to try reading this mini sequel series. It's not that great though. I mean, it's fine, but this series is really just a carrier for a bunch of cameos. It is an excuse to show all the children of the main characters of Fruits Basket. And the story itself is along very similar lines with a very anxious teenage girl kind of stumbling into the Soma family and the personal growth from that. Unfortunately, it's like really condensed, really short, really abbreviated. There are far too many characters for decent introductions or for much characterization or development over time. And that's really frustrating for me because I want a good story. I want good characters. I don't just want cameos, especially because most of the children look so much like their parents. I get them confused with their parents. But anyway, I could go on for a while about the negative stuff, but on the whole, this is just fun. And if you're a major Fruits Basket fan, you will probably want to pick it up just to see what it's like. But don't read this without having read Furuba first, because it would probably spoil things. Next, I finally finished Alliance Rising, The Hinder Stars Part 1 by CJ Cherryh and Jane S. Fancher. This is the new Alliance Union universe novel, I think the first in 20 years. And I think it's also a Company Wars book, because like the Company Wars is a series within the Alliance Union universe. And given the period of time that this book covers, right before the major events at Pell from the book Down Below Station, I think it's a Company Wars book, but I'm not really certain of the history in this universe and where the cutoff point is. But the good thing about this book is that while it has an incredibly info-dumpy beginning, it's a lot of recapping and catching the reader up on basically the historical and political situation and the trade and commerce situation of all of these space stations and stuff, which I really needed. But the beginning of this book was quite slow, very incremental development where Cherryh and Fancher felt like they were really hammering home certain concepts so that the reader would have this grounding information for the actual plot to make sense and to feel important and urgent. And I actually really liked that. I kind of wondered if a new Alliance Union novel would feel that much different from the older ones. I've been catching up on the Company Wars novels very recently, so a bunch of them are fresh in my mind. The writing style, the atmosphere created in them, I really had in my mind. So I was reading this with kind of an eye towards, does this feel any different given that it's written in like 2018 rather than in the early 1990s. And I would say that the specific style, the way that people talk and the language used, it was dead on for, you know, mimicking the older books. So it really felt like it was in the same universe. But at the same time, I noticed that there were some references to technology, like tablets, for example, that have never been mentioned in some of the other books. So there is a little bit of updating kind of creeping in, I think, but not that much. So it's kind of hard to describe what this book actually is about, but it's really about trade routes, the merchanter ships that go from space station to space station are kind of the lifeblood of this community, but the merchanter ships are kind of in conflict with the stations. They're very different ways of life serving very different interests, and this whole story, this part, and I expect the second part whenever it comes out, is kind of the build-up to the actual Merchanters Alliance, which I hadn't remembered, but is like a major thing at the end of Down Below Station. So I feel like I really need to read Down Below Station while I'm waiting for the second part of The Hinder Stars to come out. I felt like some of the depressing atmosphere from previous books had lifted somewhat. And probably because some of the main characters, you really see their way of life and the fact that they are happy in their way of life and that they have good relationships. And I think that that was kind of missing for me in some of the previous books. And also the fact that there's an absence of mental health issues and trying to treat mental health problems. And that's something that's really actually been an irritant for me in previous books, because I think that the medical, like the physical and mental health care in this universe is awful. As someone who's gone through some of this in the actual real world, I think that that's probably why I'm sensitive to it. But that was really missing in this one. I felt like characters were more actually supportive of each other rather than people just living in this vacuum, this void all on their own and not trusting anybody. So overall, just, yeah, I really got into the plot. It's quite esoteric stuff. It's all about trading and commerce and the balances of power involved in that. it was just so cool, actually. I feel like quite a nerd saying that I really enjoyed that, but I really got into it and I really want the next book. I currently have Affinity's End and 40,000 in Gehenna, which are two more from this universe, completely different time periods, I think, but I will be reading those very soon as well. Then I sped through Early Riser by Jasper Fforde. This is his first book out in quite a while. I think he had a creative dry spell for a couple of years, so this book has been long awaited. I liked it, but I have some reservations about it at the same time. So first of all, I think you could read this book as being a mashup of different genres. So like my library categorized it as just plain old fiction, but I think it has some possibly fantastical elements. It also has, you know, a massive mystery element. I actually read it like a science fiction novel, as alternate history science fiction, and so I'm judging it as science fiction, just so you know. So it's basically an alternate history where the Earth has been in basically an impending ice age for like all of human history, and humans have developed the ability to hibernate through the incredibly harsh winter. And a young man accepts a job as a trainee consul to, you know, basically be the security during winter, and he gets involved in this kind of investigation of a strange viral dream that is making people go mad and they're dying. Except that the powers that be are kind of denying the viral dream is actually a viral dream and a threat, but then this man starts having the viral dream. So it's mainly a mystery investigation, but it wasn't really tightly focused. It was really fascinating world building. I loved learning more about how the world was different, how society and history were different because of the climate difference and the hibernation. Like, people are biologically, physically a bit different because of this. And just the tiniest references to little changes and tweaks in history were really cool. Such a cool idea, pretty interesting characters. I liked the humor, I loved the footnotes, all of that, but the actual plot points were so weirdly paced and strung together. It left me feeling a lot of times like the story was unfocused and just kind of meandering. So I liked it, but it could have been better. And lastly, I finished Feersum, Endjinn by Iain M. Banks. This is a standalone science fiction novel that, as far as I know, has no connection to Banks's culture novels at all, which are the science fiction novels that he's really, really famous for. This isn't really a cyberpunk novel, but I think it's actually influenced by cyberpunk from the 80s and 90s. This was published in 1994, which means it's kind of contemporary with some of the like cyberpunk that Bruce Sterling has written, and probably also William Gibson. So the basic premise here, this is like millennia in the future on Earth. Most of humanity has left a long time ago, and the Earth is, or like the entire solar system, is under threat from this thing called the encroachment, this thing approaching that will probably end all life and cause the sun to blow up eventually. It's doomsday in a way, and it's gonna happen in about a century. Most of the action takes place within this fastness, like a gigantic castle fortress. It's literally like kilometers high, like this structure was built for giants. And I believe that it really is either the base of what was once a space elevator, or it may in fact be the space elevator. I'm kind of leaning towards the second interpretation. And there are different factions who are dealing with the encroachment differently. There are four narrators. The first one, the one that a lot of people know this book for, is Bascule. He's a teller who kind of, his job means dipping in and out of the like digital crypt world. And he is illiterate, which means that his portions of the book, about a quarter of the book overall, is written in, it's almost like phonetically, but also with almost some like internet speak using the at symbol and numbers like 1 and 2 and stuff. So it's very slow to read, and it's also like a phonetic transcription of a very strong Scottish dialect, I believe. So Bascule has some pretty amazing adventures, and if you can get through his parts of the book, some really interesting fun stuff happens there. And the whole thing with the aunt Ergates, I think that's how you pronounce it, was just, yeah. Bascule is trying to rescue his aunt, like the little insect ant thing, which was taken by a bird in the very beginning of the story. Then there is Cessine, who is a pretty high up official who is assassinated and then goes on this very long journey and evolution within the crypt when he can no longer resurrect again. He's run out of lives. Then there is Gadfium, who is a scientist and part of, I believe, the conspiracy against the king, because the king is not dealing with the encroachment well. And the final viewpoint is Asura, who is the Asura, or a Asura, like a demon from the code. Asura is a physical person who is created from the crypt and is herself probably a digital key needed to save the world from the encroachment. And all four of these people will eventually end up in the same place with kind of the same end goal, let's say. I really enjoyed the individual threads of this, but I kept forgetting what the ultimate goal was supposed to be. It wasn't until like the last couple of chapters that I really understood how all of this action related to the encroachment and what the Feersum Endjinn is. Literally, there's only one page, which is really the answer to what is the title of this. It's the very last page. But I really didn't like the crypt and virtual world stuff, and this is what I think is kind of the influence from cyberpunk, and it's something I've realized I don't necessarily love in science fiction. Digital virtual reality world stuff like the crypt tends to be, it changes very quickly, you know, with people just literally jumping from one virtual world to another or manipulating how things appear. It's also very heavy on like symbolism and imagery. What you see physically, like in appearances, is not necessarily what a thing actually is. And I just sometimes find that very confusing. I do think that the way that, let's say, virtual reality is presented here is probably more accurate than stuff I've read in other cyberpunk novels. The way that people interact with the crypt actually makes sense to me. I just felt like the parts of the book that were really about the crypt sometimes slowed it down for me. Except, with the exception of Asura's storyline, there's this whole part where she's basically a prisoner and being interrogated, but she's really secure and locked down, and the different scenarios that her captors put her in order to try and elicit information from her, that was really fascinating. That was the part of the book where some of the symbolism and some of the imagery and metaphors being used actually really clicked with me. Really different from how like Cessine's virtual reality experience was. So on the whole, I liked this. It was pretty slow to get through, especially Bascule's parts, because I can see why people abandon this book when they get to his sections, because it is very difficult to read, especially at first. And I never actually found like it got easier as I got near the end of the book. So it's not my favorite thing I've read by Banks at all, but it was pretty good. And that is it for me. Those are all the books that I've read in the past 2 weeks. Do let me know if you have read any of these, or if you want to, if they sound interesting to you, leave me a comment down below. Thank you so much for watching what was probably another very lengthy wrap-up. I know I keep apologizing for how long my videos are, but sometimes I wonder if I'm a little bit excessive in how much I talk. But anyway, thank you so much for sticking around. I'll be back again very soon. If I don't reply to comments very fast, it's because I'm gonna be busy this next week and I am so behind on replying to comments, but I will try to get better at that. So until next time, guys, Bye.